So in the previous video, we talked about the problems with valuing probabilistic outcomes using expected value. And I gave the example of the St. Petersburg paradox. In this particular game, the expected value is infinity, but it seems quite intuitively not plausible that anybody would pay a large amount of money for the privilege of being able to play this game. So, economists have come up with an alternative to expected value. And as I mentioned at the very end of our previous video, that alternative is called expected utility. And let me write mathematically what the expected utility formula is. Expected utility, EU, is the sum over I of the probability of event I, not multiplied by the payoff of event I, multiplied by the utility of the payoff of event I. This utility is defined as the welfare or the benefit or the value that somebody gets from a certain payoff. Now, we haven't talked about utility before in this class because it's a somewhat, well, I was going to say problematic concept. It's not perhaps problematic, but it's a bit hard to understand. We've always talked about willingness and ability to pay, a willingness to accept. Utility can be thought of as being the foundation for those other concepts. We don't need utility except when we're talking about uncertain outcomes and expected utility. So, in the rest of this course, I've avoided talking about utility. Although, for example, in Economics 40:10, it's a pretty core part of the way we talk about consumer theory. Now, there's a difference between utility in its really important aspect in a course like Econ 4010 and in its secondary role with uncertainty in a class like this and in this particular chapter. In a class like Econ 4010, where utility is really important, the notion of utility that we have is not one that says that you can measure utility in a way that's called cardinal, which means, well, the opposite of cardinal is ordinal. So in a class like Econ 4010, you can ask whether somebody's utility has gone up or down, but it's meaningless to ask by how much has it gone up or down. So you can say, do you like, if I give you five apples and five oranges, and then I give you one more banana, does your utility go up or down? And we use utility and utility functions in those kind of contexts, not paying any attention to utility has gone up by 3.4 utils. In fact, we explicitly say that that kind of statement is meaningless. But we're just looking for whether utility has gone up or down. So utility in those contexts, in those other classes, is something that's pretty easy to defend. Because it's not trying to say much. It's not talking about particular amounts of utility, except to say whether you've gotten happier or less happy in one situation compared to another. With the way that utility is used in risk and uncertainty, however, here we really mean something like the utility of $10 is 14.2 utils. In other words, this notion of utility here is what's sometimes called cardinal. It does imply that you can actually measure how happy somebody is. And if you take commodities away or give them more commodities, it's meaningful in this theory to say that they've gotten two more utils, or negative 1.7 utils is how their utility has changed. Economists are quite reluctant to make those kind of claims except when they're talking about risk and uncertainty. And so what we will see is that this making these kind of claims does get economists into some trouble, and that's what we'll talk about pretty soon. I don't know if it's going to be this video or the next, where we discuss problems with the expected utility. But here, let me just explain what expected utility is. So, expected utility is this formula, and utility is literally the happiness that you get from a certain payoff. So, in the table, I wanted to illustrate expected utility. And so, I put another column here, supposing that this particular consumer has a utility function that's a square root. So expected utility is the sum of the probability of each event times the square root of the payoff. Now, does anybody in real life actually have a utility function that looks like the square root? Who knows? But indeed, as I just said, the whole notion of this kind of utility function is somewhat problematic. But let's just go with it for now. And going back to the table in the St. Petersburg paradox, the payoff column is here. And so what I've done here is to take the payoff column and apply the square root to it. So if the number of the in the first column, the number of heads before the first tail, right here, the number of heads before the first tail is 0, the payoff was 2, the square root of the payoff is 1.41. In the second row, if you flipped one head before you got the first tail, the payoff was 4, the square root of 4 is 2. And so comparing this column with this column, in the third row, the square root of 8 is 2.83 approximately, the square root of 16 is 4. So here's the square root of 32, the square root of 64 is 8. So this column here is the square root of the payoffs. The last column is the probability times the payoff. I'm sorry, the probability times the square root of the payoff. So the probability is here, and the square root of the payoff is here. So this last column just multiplies those two columns together. For example, in the first row, the probability is 1/2, the square root of the payoff is 1.41. If you multiply that together, you get 0.71. Second row, probability is 1/4, square root of the payoff is 4, square root of the payoff is 2. Multiply 1/4 times 2, and you get 1/2. So each one of these is one of these. And then if you add them all up, so here's the addition, if you add them all up, you get 2.41. Whereas when you added up the when you added up the probabilities times the payoffs, you got an expected value of infinity. So in this case, the expected value of this game is infinity, and the expected utility of this game is $2.41. Now, this sounds a lot more plausible. We said it just didn't make any sense that people would be willing to give up all the money they had for a chance of playing this game one time. But it does make a lot of sense that people would be willing to pay $2.41 for the chance to play this game. Now, as I said, the $2.41 came from assuming that the utility was the square root of payoff. And I just did that to make the math easier. It's hard to say what anybody's true utility function is, and lots of economists would argue that there really is no such thing as a utility function in this kind of cardinal sense. But when we're dealing with uncertainty, we need to, if we want to model uncertainty using expected utility, then we need to have a utility function, and it has to be something. Whether it's a square root or whether it's a logarithm or whether it's some complicated polynomial, or it could be It could be very complicated. But certainly, this illustrates an advantage of expected utility over expected value, that expected utility gives an answer that's a lot less than infinity. And that certainly seems to make sense. Now, on an exam, if I were to ask you to calculate expected utility, I would have to tell you what utility function I'd want you to use. I mean, I could ask you to make it up, but we haven't talked about the what characteristics of such a function are plausible, and I'm not going to talk about that in this class. So I would probably just give it to you. And the square root is actually a function that I didn't pick randomly. It's simple, yes, but it also turns out to have properties which in higher level economics classes you learn that you want a utility function to have. So I would probably just give you the square root function. All right, so that's what expected utility is, and this describes how economists model people valuing probabilistic outcomes using expected utility. It leaves as a question mark exactly what utility function you want to use. Let me just say one more aspect of this is that this utility function doesn't in and of itself involve randomness. It's the utility of the payoff if you got the payoff for sure. And so expected utility theory is a theory of inferring how consumers are going to value probabilistic outcomes using how they value sure bets. In other words, this doesn't require any kind of complicated theory of how they analyze uncertainty. This utility function is their utility function that doesn't involve uncertainty. It's just the payoff for sure. And then expected utility says you can generate the way that they value probabilistic outcomes using the way they value non-probabilistic outcomes just by multiplying the utility of each possibility by its probability and adding them all up. So it's a good way of going from the utility of sure bets to the utility of probabilistic outcomes. Right, now I'm going to go back to my outline. I'm not sure if this will surprise you or not. It may well not. That under expected utility, we've now finished the description part, and what follows are a whole bunch of problems. Let me first say expected utility is better than expected value, right? We worked with expected value before, and we said because of things like the St. Petersburg paradox, expected value is really not the way you, I mean, it's an important thing for mathematicians to calculate, and it has something to do with the average, which obviously is important. But in terms of describing how human beings value probabilistic situations, expected value is not the way you want to go. Expected utility is a lot better. However, expected utility is not perfect. And these list of problems that I'm going to be talking about in this video and in the next are going to get into the various objections that people have using expected utility and to some extent some of the alternatives, although the alternatives are harder to use, and so most of the time economists just stick with expected utility anyway. So let me talk about problem number one. Problem number one is called the conjunction fallacy. At least that's what your book calls it. A student in a previous year mentioned that in the psychology class he was taking, it's actually called in psychology conjunction bias rather than conjunction fallacy. And the definition here is assigning higher probability to events you are personally more familiar with, and vice versa. So if you're a doctor who works with cancer patients, somebody asks you, what's the probability of somebody getting cancer over their lifetime? Your answer might be actually quite a bit higher than the actual probability of people getting cancer. Or maybe not the cancer doctor, because perhaps he's studied the epidemiology of cancer. But let's say maybe you're the receptionist for a cancer doctor. And so you're not a medical expert, but every day the people that you see in your work are all cancer patients. And then if we ask you, how likely is it that an average person gets cancer, your answer is likely to be higher than the correct probability. And you can imagine the same thing happening with other kinds of things. If you if you're a nuclear plant technician and your job is to plan for what to do in case of a nuclear accident, you might be more likely than other people to assign a higher probability if somebody asks what's the likelihood of a nuclear accident. Vice versa as well. So if you ask the receptionist for the cancer doctor, how likely is it that people die of heart attacks? Well, they don't really see many people who have heart attacks. And so that is, you as a receptionist in the cancer doctor's office don't see many people who have heart attacks. And so your answer might well be below the true probability of dying of a heart attack, just because that's an unfamiliar event to you. Okay, the next one, problem number two. Under or overweighting low probability events. Think about earthquakes in Utah, or think about nuclear power plant accidents. Now, when I was first writing my notes, and when I first started teaching this book, that was, we hadn't had an earthquake in Utah in quite a while, certainly not a major earthquake. Now, we had one in 2020. It wasn't particularly large, but there was a damage to some buildings. And so perhaps people are more aware of earthquakes in Utah than they were before 2020. In addition, when I first started teaching this, this was before the Fukushima nuclear power plant in Japan had a meltdown after the tsunami. So maybe now people are more likely to think about nuclear power plant accidents than they were before. But when your book was written, it had been, well, I guess there were nuclear power plants accidents when your book was written too, in Three Mile Island, and in Ukraine. But let's just think about situations where you have bad events don't happen very often, and if bad events don't happen very often, or good events for that matter too, low probability events, people often assume that these probabilities are zero, or act as if the probabilities are zero. So if something happens with a probability of, let's say, 1% per year, most people are never going to witness such an event, and so they act as if the probability is zero, but it really isn't. Or what if something happens with a probability of 5% per year? It still might be many, many years before someone witnesses that kind of event. And so, well, so that explains underweighting of low probability events. And I think the underweighting is more likely with something like earthquakes in Utah, where people act like Utah's never going to have a dangerous earthquake. How about overweighting? Well, sometimes people get, the experts say, irrationally scared of events like nuclear power plant accidents. And it's, since they are rare events, it's hard to know whether you're assigning the correct probability to them because they happen so rarely. And In any case, what you find is that some people seem to overweight some low probability events like nuclear power plant accidents. And obviously, if people are not using the right probabilities, this isn't a, this, in neither problem number one nor problem number two is really a problem with expected utility theory in general. What it's saying instead, what these two are saying instead, is that people don't judge the probabilities right. And so they're using the wrong probability numbers. So the formula is expected utility is the sum over all possible outcomes of the probability of the event times the utility of the payoff in case that event occurs. And problem number one and problem number two are getting at people using the wrong probabilities. Some of the other problems are like that, but others will take aim at the second part, which is the utility of the payoff and those functions. But we'll stop here for now.